Today's journey to the Middle Ages centers on six unicorn tapestries from around 1500 that now hang in the Cluny Museum in Paris. How are they made? Based on drawings created in Paris, they were woven by Flemish artisans from wool and silk using the mi-fleur technique. At the time, tapestries were considered more prestigious even than paintings, for they added both beauty and warmth to the French aristocrats' halls that they adorned. Fast forward to the 19th century, when the tapestries were rediscovered, moldering in some corner of a French castle, providing snack food for rats. The novelist George Sands, which is a pen name, took up the cause of their preservation, correctly deducing from the fashions worn by the women that the tapestries had been made in the late 15th century. Soon thereafter, the Cluny Museum in Paris acquired these textiles. Although tapestry scholars sometimes assess this set in the Cluny as merely being of so-so quality, these six tapestries have continued to capture the wider public's imagination and even appear as a sort of extra special wizard wallpaper in a certain popular movie franchise. Why this fascination? In my opinion, they conform to era modern notions of medieval court culture, and also they prominently feature unicorns, which are awesome. A mythic beast whose depictions were as popular in the Middle Ages as now. Each of the five senses are represented in their own wall hanging, and the idea of chunking out our sensory perception of the world into five discrete senses goes back to at least the ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle, who wrote on the topic in his work De Anima. The unnamed lady demonstrates the sense of touch in the way she holds the unicorn's horn. Above her flies the family crest of the Leviste family. Debate surrounds which member of the family commissioned this set of tapestries, but it's most likely to be Jean IV Leviste, who served under King Charles VII. The Taste tapestry bears down on the connection to the Leviste family, for we see the crest again, and the sense of taste is depicted two ways. The lady reaches for a treat from the bowl held by her attendant, and the monkey below is enthusiastically devouring a sweetmeat. The tray of carnations, from which the lady has plucked a flower, testifies that this tapestry represents smell. Likewise, a monkey also sniffs a flower. Hearing is vividly evoked with this musical ensemble surrounding a portable organ. Often considered the most important sense, medieval notions of sight might seem surprising to us now, such as a widespread theory that posited eyes transmitted rays. The mirror held by the lady anchors how sight is shown, for the kneeling unicorn gazes upon himself with an adorable little unicorn reflection you can see in the mirror. The lady turns her gaze to this beast, who according to medieval texts such as in the bestiary tradition, symbolized Christ and could only be captured after being calmed by a maiden. And in the sight tapestry, the unicorn does seem particularly docile. Taken together, this set rendering five senses symbolize the sensory pleasures of courtly life, but there may also have been a layer of moralized meaning too. Perhaps they are meant to offer an allegory of these pleasures' renunciation, and for that theory, we should turn to the last tapestry. Here the lady puts away the box of beautiful jewels she wore in the prior five senses, and this simple gesture has been seen as representing her renunciation of the worldly senses. Another way of looking at it, though, is perhaps this wall hanging represents a sixth sense, that of understanding. Most interpretations hinge on the words, which are often translated in English as, "to my only desire." But again, even those words can have a range of potential meanings. Part of why it's so hard to pinpoint the meaning of this tapestry is maybe, just maybe, it wasn't meant to be analyzed this way. A feature of tapestries of the time is that the subjects are often quite ill-defined, since they were elegant and expensive backgrounds for courtly life, but perhaps weren't given much scrutiny beyond that. Also, at the time these tapestries were made, the unicorn was not considered a mythic animal by everyone. For example, in 1483, a Dominican friar recounted seeing a unicorn on his journeys in the Sinai Peninsula. There's even another set of unicorn tapestries in New York's Cloisters Museum, also made around 1500 in Flanders. So, Whether considered by medieval viewers as fabulously exotic or just fabulous, unicorns are represented across late medieval art, and this is surely one of the most intriguing medieval representations of that beast that survives.